Today is the day that the Lord has made. When I woke up in the morning, that is what came into my mind. This is the day that the Lord has made. And I will rejoice and be glad in it. It's not just a day, but I have to make a choice that I'm going to rejoice in this day. The day that is called today. And you know, you wake up, you have a headache, you wake up, but you decide. It doesn't matter how I feel, but this day, I purpose to rejoice and to be glad in it. Amen. Tell your neighbor, neighbor, I don't know what is happening to you, but this is the day. Oh, this is the day. Tell them like you are serious. Let's be glad in it. Blessed be the name of the Lord. We are going on in the book of Habakkuk, and we started Habakkuk chapter 2, and today we will still be in Habakkuk chapter 2, and the title is Choices. Tell your neighbor, Choices. You see, we have heard it said many times, and that our choices matter. Choices are important. Choices are important. We know this true because all of life is shaped by the choices we make. We make our choices, and then our choices, in turn, they make us. So you become the choices that you have made. And you know, as I ponder the situation, I realize that at the age of 63, I am nothing more than the sum total of all the choices that I've made. Some of you have no idea, but even choosing to go to Kenyona to marry Alice is a choice that has made me. I know some of you think, choice? Yes, it is. Even this guy from Subukia, to choose to come to Narumoro, the choice he made is the sum total of the choices that we make. And it is unless you sit down and become a little sober, then you discover even the high school you went to, the choice of the high school that you chose has affected you. You are who you are, the sum total of all the choices that you have made. There is no place, even the high school we went, you know, some of us say, oh, hiyo shule nilisukumwa. Hata hiyo uliosukumwa. The fact that you are there, that choice is also adding up to who you are. So you can tell your neighbor, imagine I'm a sum total of all my choices. So the choices that you make are important. You better know that. So I have discovered over the years that I'm what I am, I'm where I am, doing what I do as a result of the thousands of choices made over a long period of time. Made choices. I chose that I will not drink. I chose that I will not smoke. And those have their consequences too. Choices are so important and so crucial. We make our choices, then our choices in turn make us. That's it. So the first thing is, if you're going to make a choice, know that that choice that you're going to make, little as it is going to affect you. And some of you have no idea. Even when we become, we have some habits. We start those habits without knowing, but those habits have a way of turning us and making us the way we are. Even in the years to come. Because our choices matter, the Bible speaks often of choices. Nearing the end of the life of Moses, Moses challenges people this way in Deuteronomy 30 and verse 19. He says, "This day I call the heavens and the others witnesses against you that I have set before you life and death, blessing and curses. Now choose life so that you and your children may live." In other words, if you choose curses, your children will not live. If you don't choose blessing, your children are not going to live. But if you choose life, so whatever choices you make, they make you. Joshua, as an old man and nearing death, he reminded the people of Israel about what God had done for them. Then he exhorted them with these words. "But if serving the Lord seems undesirable to you, then choose for yourself this day whom you will serve, whether the gods your ancestors served beyond the Euphrates or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you are living. But as for me and my house, we shall serve the Lord." Many years later, Elijah stood up on Mount Carmel and addressed the people of Israel this way.
How long will you waver between two opinions? If the Lord is God, follow him. But if Baal is God, then follow him. Make a choice. You cannot in between. You have to make a decision. Either here or there. You cannot be on two wars. Huwezi kaa utapasuka. Huwezi kaa hivyo. So that is 1 Kings 18:21. In Psalms 1 and verse 6, the Lord watches over the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked will perish. It is important for us to know that we have choices. You choose the way of life, you will live. You choose the way of death, you will die. Solomon has these words also. He said in Proverbs 14 and verse 12, there is a way that seems right to a man, but its end is death. There is a way. You have to make a choice. You have to make a choice. Then the Lord Jesus Christ sums up by saying these words in Matthew 7, 13 and 14. Enter by the narrow gate, for the gate is wide and the way is easy that leads to destruction. And many there find which go in thereat. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Verse 14. Because straight is the gate and narrow is the way. But small is the gate and narrow the road that leads to life. And only a few find it. So every person here listening to me, we are on a journey. Leads to life or death. And Jesus calls the way of life. If you choose it, you will live. It is narrow. It is hard. It is not used by many people. Many people use the easier way. They even will tell you everybody is doing it, so we want to do it. It is easier. But the Lord says, no, make sure you're on the right road. You don't want to end up in a place you never wanted to be in the first place. Make a choice, and your choices will make you. Decide as early as you can. I'm going to live a holy life. Decide as early as you can. I will not do this until I get married. Decide as early as you can. I will never entertain this, entertain the other. As early as you can. And I tell you, to shape you. But if everything else coming along the way, hata kila kitu unasema ni sawa, maisha yako itakuwa na shida. So this brings me back to where I started. Our choices really do matter. We make our choices, and our choices in turn make us. Yesterday in the TV, there was a girl that was talking about choices she made. She came from a very strict family. You know, I don't know, why do you guys that have come back from your busy schedule for the last 3 months think we are tight on you? Wait until the world will be tight on you. I mean, we tight on you? Man. Na ukitaka chips tunakupatia. Hai. Ati chapa zimeenda low, tunakuinua. And we are tight on you. Wait until the world gets hold of you. Because this world has no mercy. Haki haina. Hii dunia. Hii. Wasichana. Simuliona moja amegongwa nyundo. Wasichana. Hiyo sio ujumbe yangu. Ni kusema nasema tu, wewe amua. Mambo ya werere hutaki. Sponsor hutaki kitu yake. Amua tu. Mimi hii sumu ninapewa na wazazi wangu. Nitaikula vizuri. I'm telling you. Make your decision and choices early. Oh, I know the others say, oh, angalia sponsor. Angalia, angalia bling bling hii. Ni ya sponsor. Na hii ingine bling bling. Unaona ni ya? Wacha. When the sponsor will come asking for the sponsorship fee, demanding their right. Now that is where life becomes a bit difficult and hard. Ebu mwambie jirani yako, hakuna kitu ya bure. Hata nyinyi wazee, nyinyi wazima mko hapa mnanisikia. Ukiona mtu ameanza kukupatia tip, na anataka kukupatia wewe in particular, hammer, make sure you don't serve that site. If you are a waiter, turn around and go somewhere else. Because one day that tip might become something else. Kata, sitaki, iyo tip yako enda na. I'm telling you, make a choice. Because the choices that you make will make you. So this girl was saying, the parents were very tough. Akaingia, the campus. You know, there is a place we call the campus. Na iyo campus, hebu tuambie watu wa the campus. Sasa tumekuwa tu campuses twingi. So siku hizi, yote ni campus. So this girl is in Nairobi University. And this girl starts very well. But she said this at a certain time with other girls because of freedom. Now you are free, you with other girls. So she decided they will start nakunywa bangi. Bangi ni kama sigara. Haina madhara. Wakaanza kusema, si tuanze tu tuone. So wakasema, tutavuta bangi wiki tatu. Alafu tuwache. Walipovuta wiki tatu wakasikia, sio mbaya sana vile walikuwa wakifikiria. Naye yule alikuwa akiwapatia bangi, mwanaume huyo, akawaambia kuna ingine level. Level ingine, kidogo tu, another small level. Akawapatia powder, akawaambia waichome vizuri, waiweke kwa shindano, wajidunge nayo. Wakasema tutafanya hivyo wiki mbili tu. Walipofanya wiki mbili, ikawa sasa hawezi fanya kitu bila kujidunga. Mchitiana akashindwa na kusoma, miaka miwili wazazi wanafikiria anasoma, hasomi lakini yako university. Ikafika mahali university hawezi kaa, kaenda chorochoroni, inje. Either you sell your bodies to get those drugs or you do something silly or stupid for you to get those drugs. But she was so happy that she was alive because her friends had died. Kwa sababu yoshindana ukijidunga, when you are not high, unaongeza dawa. Wengi wakakufa kwa overdose. Now the point I'm bringing is, the choice she made was not that. Ni kukuvuta bangi tu. Tena tutavuta wiki tatu. Kama uko hapa na umnaanza kuvuta bangi. Ikikushika, haitakuwa wiki tatu. Itakuwa kitu kitakumaliza wewe kijana ama wewe msichana. Hiyo pombe wachana nayo. Make good choices. Choose good friends. Choose good life. Choose the way you are going to live. Hata afadhali nguo zako uzinunuage Gikomba. Na wale wengine wanakuringia vile zao zinatoka Moringo, Angamoringo, Angamoremo. Whatever it is, wacha, kaa tu ngumu. Siku moja anayewakumbuka watu wake, atakukumbuka wewe. Just be faithful because choices, they make us. So what is happening to Habakkuk? Habakkuk is finding, really, he has to make a choice. And the choice he has to make is to follow Jesus wholly because Babylon will be judged. They might appear like they are doing very well, but somehow they will be judged. So what do we find? We find out in this little book that in chapter 1 we can say they are speaking to each other. Habakkuk and God are speaking to each other. But in chapter 2, God is the one speaking to Habakkuk. And in chapter 3, which we are going to go to, Habakkuk will be speaking to God. So when trouble comes to us, that's the time you discover quickly, what do you really believe? When you have trouble, what do you really believe? So as we pick the story in chapter 2, there are three things that God is telling Habakkuk, and I want to repeat again, and I said it last Sunday. Number one, God is telling Habakkuk, write. Tell your neighbor, write. Afadhali uandike. Useme mimi ninisema nitaolewa kutoka miaka 28. Period. Na ukatalie pale. Hata wakileta Mercedes ya kukua ukiwa na 24, umwambie kama unanipenda sana goja 28. What is wrong with that? Oh, najua wadada ni wengi. Sasa ukiona mtu akukua hata ukiwa 21. Wacha mchezo. Choices. You know, I attended a wedding. The girl was 17 and the boy was 19. It is not in this country, so. There are countries that when you're above 15, you can get married. But they started crying, both of them, in the wedding. Both of them. Msichana analia ile ya kutokwa na ngoro. It was in Sweden. Analia. Kwa sababu anashindwa sasa kuolewa ni nini? Because at 17 actually kuolewa ni nini? At 17, hebu muulize msichana ama ndugu aliye karibu naye. Ukiwa 17 kuolewa ni nini? Walianza kulia hapo. Kijana ako 19. Na msichana ako 17. Na nikauliza pastor aliyekuwa akiwaoza ambaye alikuwa rafiki yangu, what are you doing? This girl is crying. Will you do this? She's crying. And say, yeah, I will do. Will you do this? Yeah, I will do. And the guy is saying the same, I wonder. Sasa watoto wawili ukipeleka kwa nyumba, huyu akililia mama yake na huyu alilie mama yake. Mama wao wote wawili wafike pale. Zitakuwa vita. choices, the choices that we make. But write down your dream. This is me at age 20. This is what I want to become at age 30. This is me in school at age 21. This is what I want to become at age 40. This is me at age 12. Start even as early as you can, but make sure you write. Write your dream, write whatever God brings your way. Because if you write, then you can look. But don't, usikue kama watu wengine hapa. Ebu angalia jirani yako. Kama naandika kwa karatasi, umuambie hiyo ni mchezo itapotea tu. Muambie tu. Hiyo. Ati amepasua karatasi. Hiyo muambie hiyo. Hiyo, hiyo. Hiyo tu ni style ya kupotea tu. Utaiweka hapa, ukitoa utatupa. Mwambie anunue kitabu. Mwambie tu tafadhali, mu encourage. Mwambie wacha kuandika kwa karatasi, wacha tu. Hiyo ni bishop unaonyesha ati unachukua notes zake. Hamna. But next time come to a book in church, write something. What you hear God saying, write it. When you come for prayer, write the dreams, write the vision, so that even after many years you can go back to look at it. It is those things that I have written that I have always been able to know when God answers. It is those things that we have agreed with Alice, and we write down when they happen, we know the Lord has answered. We start in January and we start with the things that we have forgotten. We say, this year, this is what we are going to do. And even if it doesn't happen at the end of the year, we can look back and say, this one did not happen. Lakini ukiishi ndena fua, whatever happened, then whatever happens. Whatever happens, whatever happens. Choices. So the first thing that Habakkuk is saying, write. And that one we found in verse number 2. Write down the revelation. Write down the vision. And make it plain on tablets so that a herald may run with it. The Living Bible puts it very well. It paraphrases it this way. Write my answer on a billboard. Large and clear. So that anyone can read it at a glance. And rush to tell others. God wants to make his will clear. What he says to Habakkuk is not some secret, coded message only for the prophet. Instead, it is a message for the whole nation. He's telling Habakkuk, write and say, Babylon, your time is coming to an end. Your time is coming to an end. And you remember for 70 years, nothing happened. Yes, write it. Let everybody know that one day Babylon will be judged. In other words, write. Immorality will be judged as right. Ignorant will be judged as right. Make it bold. Let people see it, because it will be judged one day. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Write it big. Tell your neighbor, have you written your dream? Write it big. Number 2, he says in verse number 3, wait. Now, waiting is not easy. And you know when you wait, it appears too long to see a doctor, waiting on the queue to see a doctor. And you know, waiting is everywhere. Waiting in a bank, waiting in a matatu, waiting. Oh, waiting. It is waiting to have a baby, waiting for the baby to go to school, waiting for the baby to leave home. You know, there are some of us that are waiting for them to leave home. You waited for them to come. You've been waiting for them to leave home. Imagine, all your life you've been waiting. You waited for them to be born. You waited for them to go to school. You waited for them to leave home. Now some of you are waiting for them to leave home. And then after they leave home, you'll be waiting for grandchildren. And after that, you'll be waiting for grandchildren to have grandchildren. This life is waiting. But as you wait, what do you do? What do you do as you wait? He is reminded. It speaks of the end, and it will not prove false. Though it linger, wait for it. It will suddenly come, and it will not delay. Has God said anything to you? If you have written it, wait, because God is going to bring it to pass in the name of the Lord. It might appear it is taking too long. It might appear like you have been forgotten. You know, sometimes we ask, God, do you still remember I exist? Because you know why you're asking God that is because the guy you went to school with has been blessed. He has even got married to a good man and so on. And he married a good girl and you are in school together. So that waiting, you feel like God has forgotten. But God has not forgotten. Wait. Certainly, it will come and will not delay. God may seem slow, but he is never late. He never delays in order to hurt us. He's an on-time God. So when it delays, there is a reason. There is a purpose. This is what he's trying to tell Habakkuk. You're asking why, but I have a reason and a purpose, and I will answer the same. But write the vision, write the revelation, so that when it happens, you will know. Have you ever noticed that when you are praying for something really big, you know there are some things that are really big, it takes a whole long time for it to happen. And sometimes you want to give up, you want even to change, and sometimes you think, maybe this was not God, it was myself. A preacher comes from Nigeria in this service and is preaching to all of us, and he tells us that some of us, he gives us 21 days or 3 months or 6 months of this will happen and that will happen. Oh, we get so excited. Yes! Then 3 months, nothing happened. 6 months, nothing happened. And then we just give up. Now, I will give up if it was the Nigerian man. But if it is the Lord, I will never. I'll keep on holding. Because a Nigerian man can tell me 1 week because he's a human being. And 1 day with God is 1,000. So as far as God is concerned, he could still be with his timing. So I want to wait on God, but I have to write it down so that as I wait, I will look at it on and on and on again. I think it is good at every intervals, every quarter of a year, to go back and see the things that you wrote. What did you write in January? What has God done to you? What is God going to do? Have you planned? What have you planned? So God is saying to Habakkuk, it is not today, it is not tomorrow, but the answer is on the way. Hold on, wait for it. He even says, it will certainly come. In other words, it will come. It will come. Not today, not tomorrow, but it will come. And it will come in his own time. There is a song that I like listening, which says it's a promise. God never promised that you'll never have headache or stomachache or problem or even die. He never said that you'll never have a problem. He never said. But what he promised is that he's going to be with you. Now, once you know he's going to be with you, it doesn't matter what the problem and the challenge is. Do you want to listen to that song? Please, let's listen to that song just a little. It's a promise. Oh, it's a good song. It's a good song. You will love it. Utaipenda. Inakuja tu, mwambie jirani yako kuwa na imani. Inakuja tu, na utaipenda. Not today, not tomorrow, but the answer is on the way. Hold on, wait for it. There is a promise. It will certainly come. Hizo ndizo zile nyimbo ninapendaga sana.
I never said that I would give you silver or gold, or that you would never feel the fire or shiver in the cold. But I did say you'd never walk through this world alone. I did say, don't make this world your home. I didn't say that fear wouldn't find you in the night, or that loneliness was something you'd never have to fight. But I did say, I'd be right there by your side. Thank you, sweet Jesus. And I did say, I'll always help you fight. 'Cause you know I made a promise that I intend to keep. My grace will be sufficient in every time of need. Turn their backs on you, or that the world around you wouldn't surely be despised. And I did say, my ways confound the wise. The bitter kiss of death, or have to walk through chilly Jordan to enter into rest. But I did say I'd be waiting right on the other side. Yeah, yeah, yeah. And I did say I'll dry every tear you cry.
I've made to you. The promise, there is a promise that God is going to be with us. He has not promised us silver and gold, but when we even don't have it, He has promised to be with us. He is our source of supply. He's everything. So when sickness or death or danger or calamity comes our way, or what Habakkuk is being reminded, make a choice between serving him and believing him and believing his promise. His ways are not our ways. He answers in different ways. And I told you the other day, even the devil can be sent to bring you a loaf of bread in the morning. Once you receive it, thank the devil and kick him out in the name of the Lord and praise God for the provision. The third thing that Habakkuk is told by God is, remember. See, the enemy is puffed up. His desires are not upright. But the righteous person will live by his faithfulness, or the just will live by faith. Indeed, one betrays him. He is arrogant and never at rest. Because he is as greedy as the grave and like death, he is never satisfied. He gathers to himself all the nations and take captive all the peoples. Verse 4 and 5. In other words, Habakkuk, write and say, Babylon, you are condemned and you are judged. It doesn't matter what people have said to you. Remember that God has already judged them. God has already judged them. God has already judged them. God may seem slow, but he's never late. In the midst of the rampage of terror, what should the people of God do? The answer we find in verse number 4 towards the end. The righteous person will live by his faithfulness, or the just shall live by faith. What do you do when they are killing you? The just shall live by faith. What do you do when the enemy destroys your home? The just shall live by faith. What do you do when they sack you from your place of work? The just shall live by faith. What do you do when they have taken some of our people into captivity? The just shall live by faith. What do you do when the Muslim falsely accuse you of adultery and apostasy? They sentence you to death and shackle you to the floor in the prison cell. If you are Dr. Miriam Ibrahim, what would you do, say? What would you do? The just shall live by faith. What would you do if they accuse you wrongly? Or they say things that are not right? The point is, the just shall live by faith. That little phrase, tackled at the end of verse 4, changed Apostle Paul, changed a monk called Martin Luther. Why? Because if that is true, then whatever I do, I will live in faith, because the just shall live by faith. Luther says, when by the Spirit of God I understood these words. I pray that we can understand those words. The whys that we ask, all what we need to is to understand. The just shall live by faith. There are five woes that I find here, and I'm telling these woes to the enemy of the church, the enemy of the people that I preach to, the enemy that come and linger around you. But before I do it, I want to go back and try a song, but not sing, but try a song which was sung by Johnny Cash. Johnny Cash sang a good song. He was a Christian songwriter and singer and composer. He says this, you can run
on for a long time. Run for a long time. Run for a long time. Sooner or later, God will cut you down. Sooner or later, God will cut you down. Go tell them. Go tell that midnight writer. Go tell that tongue liar. Go tell the rambler and the gambler and the backbiter. Go tell them that God is going to cut them. In other words, your enemy should know that God will vindicate you. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Tell them God is going to cut them to pieces. Who are these people? Number one, he says, the first woe is people who do extortion. Extortion. Woe to him who piles up stolen goods. It doesn't matter whoever has stolen from you. The Bible is telling me he's already judged. Woe to him. That perfectly described Babylonians, but it also described the people living with us today. They love silver and gold. They can take it from anyone. But we are saying if they have stolen from you, the time for them to return back is now in the name of Jesus. Why? Because they are condemned. It might take 2 days, 3 days, 4 days, 1 week, 1 month, 1 year. But if the Lord has said, I'll write it down, that one day those that owe me, they'll pay me. How do you feel when somebody just calls you one time and he tells you, nimekutumia? Namoe nini, nimekutumia? Chapa, zimetoka wapi? Nizile, 2010. Goodness, heaven. May they do it to you. May they do it quickly. Those that owe you, may they pay you back. Some of you are contractors. Some of you are people that have done so much, but people are holding on to your money. May they write checks and bring them to you. Why? Woe to the people that are holding our money and our resources. That's what God is telling Habakkuk. Usijali wamekuibia, watarudisha. Hallelujah. Oh, I like that. Watarudisha. How about the arrogance? He says, woe to the arrogant. Woe to whom will build his house by unjust gain, setting his nest on high to escape the clutches of ruin. The arrogant, Habakkuk is told, don't you worry, because a time is coming that I'm going to judge them too. It refers to the part of walls of Babylon, in some places 100 feet high, stretching at least 40 miles around the city. The Babylonians thought they cannot be penetrated. But I'm saying, it doesn't matter. If you have stolen from us and you have made a war, we are going to blow the war. We are going to go round the war for 7 days. And on the seventh day, we are going to go seven times. And the wall of Jericho is going to crumble down. It doesn't matter. Just identify. Ni nani huyo? Ni nani huyo? The stones of the wall will cry out and the beams of the woodwork will echo it out, because we are calling on God. You see, although for 70 years nothing happened to Habakkuk, Daniel in the book of Daniel tells us it happened. We told you that Habakkuk and Daniel were contemporaries. Now Daniel tells us in Daniel chapter 5 that Belshazzar was the king of Babylon, and he had a banquet, and people were drinking, and he brought the holy vessels from Jerusalem, and they were using them to drink. And then suddenly a hand appeared on the wall. It was written, mene, mene. God is so good. May a hand appear on my enemy, writing mene, mene. May it appear that whatever they have stolen from me, that wall is coming down. That war is coming down. The kingdom crumbled. Actually, the Bible says that night, Belshazzar died. There's somebody that has to die. You know, sometimes these jokes of dying, you know, sometimes when you say somebody has to die, people feel, upon Uzema wakufa. You know, some people have to go. Okay, to Uzema wakufa, to Zemeto, some people have to go. You know, Kenyatta had to go for Moi to come in, right? Yeah. Moi had to go for Kibaki, right? And Kibaki had to go for Uhuru. And Uhuru will have to go for whoever. Now, that is for politicians. Here I can see some of you, you know, kuna tanga tanga group na kuna hiyo ingine, whichever group you are in. But one day Uhuru has to go, right? But the point that I'm bringing, I'm just saying that king had to die, and he died with his kingdom. It was divided. Woe is to the arrogant. You know, I normally tell people, hata ukipewa mali, kula
kura na uhambo yourself. You know, how many people remember? Was he Maina Wanjiro? Remember somebody, Maina Wanjiro? Maina Wanjiro, from where we come from. You know, it is good to associate ourselves with good people on the good part. But where he died, we say, huyo jamaa wa huko. Huyo jamaa wa huko. We understand that guy was so proud. Proud. Kwa sababu kalipata pesa. Hii pesa. Unajua kuna pesa ingine ukipata itakuua. Mwambie Mungu akupatie pesa ya kukusaidia. Kuna pesa ingine akikupatia inakuua tu. Kajamaa kalipewa pesa. Akipita kwa soko anapiga nyanya za watu anakuangishia ngiri. Yani na anakuangalia tu. Kifo chake hakijulikani ni yeye alijirusha ama ni kurushwa alirushwa. But whatever it is, alikufa. Pesa zingine zinaletaka kiburi. Kiburi. Na kiburi si kizuri. So humble yourself. Tell your neighbor, humble yourself. Hey, Bwana sifiwe. Bwana sifiwe. We humble yourself. Ndiyo tunaona rinda yako ni mpya. Hata inaonekana imetoka majuu, but humble yourself. Hey, yo kiatu yako tunaona ni moto wa kuotea mbali. Humble yourself, you know. Hiyo nyumba yako niliona ni safi sana. Humble yourself. It is always good. Humble yourself. How about bloodshed? Number three, woe to him who builds a city with bloodshed and establishes a town by injustice. Habakkuk is being told, don't you worry, I will revenge. I'm coming and I'm going to do something to those people that do those things. God hates those who build an empire on bloodshed. You see, even in this country, don't think it is Uhuru who is doing whatever he's doing. God is so mad about people who don't care about you, but they make your sweat. They enjoy your sweat. And then they live on your sweat, and what is left, they come and take it from the poor. Do you know the people who do taxes in this country are the poor because we have no lawyers? You know, I met a rich man and I was listening. At all, I had a sijui, nilikuwa na court, nilikuwa nilipe milioni 24 uko KRA. Alafu nikamuliza ulilipa ngapi? Nilipa tu 1.2. Now, if you follow the story, it is 1.2, but maybe it's only 200 that go to the government. So who pays the taxes in this country? Siniwe na mimi. Hawa watu wakubwa walipi. But God is saying, if they have built their empire on blood, that God will bring judgment on them. Amen. Hiyo kilio yako inamfikia Mungu. I like this verse, verse number 14, because this one gives me hope. Habakkuk, this is what is going to happen. Habakkuk, it has taken 70 years. But even as the troubles get worse, listen to this. But the earth will be covered with the knowledge of the glory of the Lord as the waters cover the sea. In other words, just see the glory of the Lord covering this country as waters covers the sea. There is the glory of the Lord that covers this country as the waters that covers the sea. There is the presence of the Lord that we can feel in Zimmerman, which covers this Zimmerman as the waters covers the sea. That is the promise which gives us, tells us, hata kama ameniahidi na imechukua muda bado nitakaa. Kwa nini? Utukufu wa Mungu, the glory of the Lord. Here God pulls back the curtain to give us a glimpse and to give Habakkuk a glimpse. The world is not getting better, but even as it gets worse, there is a time that the whole earth will be filled with the glory of the Lord. Come, Lord Jesus Christ, come even now. In the name of the Lord, Jesus will return to this earth. The earth that rejected him, he will come and bring peace. Hallelujah. He will come, not with the standing of the bloodshed, not with the standing of pornography that is all over the place, not with the standing the immorality, not with the standing of the injustice and the greed. He is coming back. And this earth will be filled with the glory of the Lord as the water covers the sea. Wow, blessed be the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Immorality. Woe to him who gives drink to his neighbors, pouring from the wineskin till they are drunk so that they can gaze on their naked bodies. You see, immorality, whatever it is, it will be judged. And you know, I want to plead with the young people, as those that have come home and those that come home. Please, this place is holy. Please, this place is holy. Don't get curses in the house of the Lord. Don't walk with a phone to watch pornography in this house, because God will punish you. And I'm saying as a servant, because it has been echoed that there are some young people that come, they don't listen to anything. They are watching pornography when I'm preaching. Woe unto you. Why don't you stay home? Why don't you want a curse for nothing? Stay home. Stay outside. Or even if you are a mature person, this is not the place to come and start googling and so on. Immorality will be judged. The immorals will be judged. Brother, sister, immorality will be judged. Whether you are calling it an affair, it will be judged. Woe to him who gives drink to his neighbor so that you can take advantage of them. Woe to you. There is a curse upon you. Hey, why? Siata unasikia kumenyamazika. You see, pombe. Hata wale mko hapa mnakunywa pombe, wachana nayo tu. Pombe ina madhara yake. Ina masara yake. Hallelujah. And then finally, idolatry. Woe to him who says to the wood, come to life, or to lifeless stone, wake up. You know, people who worship those things, stones and money and so on. Woe unto you. I want to finish by saying this. When I look at what Habakkuk is saying, you know, every time you read something, and especially when I looked at this and the choices that Habakkuk is trying to talk about, I know waiting is hard, and as you wait, you can despair. But I think Habakkuk is trying to say something else that I think is critical for us. He's asking the choice that you're going to make. And actually, it's like he's saying, which team are you in? Is it Liverpool or Manchester? Which team are you in? Is it Babylonian team or Jesus' team? Which team are you in? Because you see, it is critical. If you have watched a match, it all depends with which team you are in. If you are a Manchester person and Liverpool is losing, you are so happy because Liverpool iko juu. Si afadhali hapa ni jienjoy kidogo. Si mulikuwa menienjoy kwa muda mrefu. But which team are you in? The team Babylon right now, it seems like it is winning the game. It appears like they have scored 4 and it is halftime. Team Jesus is still struggling. Team Jesus is still playing the game, but they are still struggling. And it is 15 minutes to time. But we know Team Jesus won. You know, it is like watching a game and you have seen the result before. You know, if you have seen a game before and you are watching with somebody, anakusikiria huruma Liverpool. Sapa mulichapwa. Oh, mlikuwa mechapwa mbili, eh? Oh, Liverpool, mumeshindwa. Na namwambia goja bwana, goja mpira uishe. Because you know it will only take 10 minutes and pa, 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 4-2. And that is the same story. Team Jesus has lost so far. It appears like the world is gaining. The economy of this world is held by sinners. Seems like the sinners are winning. Education is owned by sinners. It seems like in education they are winning. Industries are owned by sinners. They appear like they are winning. Everything appears like it is being won by Team Babylon. But I have a word for Team Babylon. The Bible tells me that the kingdoms of this world will become the kingdom of God and His Son. And He will establish His kingdom forever. Team Jesus, we are winning. Which team are you on? Is it Babylon and team or Jesus' team? Because Jesus' team is winning. Look at your neighbor and tell them, neighbor, the just shall live by faith. Tell another one. Look at another one. Tell them, the just shall live by faith. And encourage them. Make a good choice. Because choices will make you. The Lord bless you.
Thank you for watching. Today's message, I think it has been a blessing to you. And I pray that you will pass it on to somebody else. Hope to see you next time. In Jesus' name.